Oh, I hit the wrong button. There it is. There it is. There it is. Hold on. I hit the wrong button.
No.
Now, it should pop up here. There it is. And then one more button and the team names are good. Look at that, guys. All right, guys. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get this game underway. Notch, I know you're ready. Ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready,
I'm
though?
I'm so ready. I'm so ready.
So I don't know that you're ready. 3, 2, 1. And we're in there. Again, taking a look at the drafts, it appears that Steel and Muriel were the bands, judging by the process of deduction, which is the only reason why I was so good at testing in high school. Let's take a look at these teams. Let's introduce them. On the blue side of the map is going to be Warpath Gaming. And it's going to be Easy Peasy on Murdoch, Cordy on Sparrow, Kirby on Iggy and Scorch, Peace Turtle on Decker, and Rassy on Rampage. Who do we have minions on the other side of the field?
For Baylife, we've got Thurborn on Twin Blast, Undead Pilot on Murdoch, Aisu on Rampage, Solario on Decker, and Force on Iggy and Scorch.
So
Iggy,
guys,
and Scorch, man.
More Iggy, man. What type of build do you think we're going to see? It's hard to predict, but is it going to be a Bixel build? Or?
I think we're going to see a tanky build. I think we're going to see a little bit of a tanky build. I feel like it's the best way to play that hero. That's my prediction. All I can say right now is tanky build. We're so early on in this game. I can't tell by his two mana pets and a health pot what we're going to do here until we see that first item. But I personally am thinking a tank build keeps him in lane longer, lets it so he can be a little bit more aggressive and not have to worry about the gank, and he can really, really split push well that way.
Yeah.
We do see quite a bit of posturing here right at the mid. They, of course, set down wards, went back, sold, and they're now coming. Peace Turtle's got his Lord's Key to put Harvesters, but just a little bit of posturing mid. I think we'll see the lane game here start to form up in just a minute.
Interesting. Wrath Z is electing to go with the Overflowing Gifts. Normally, this is something we see put on like a Muriel or a Decker or something like that. But not the case. Actually picking up on Rampage instead. So nonetheless, they still have the utility of that item, of that card, rather. Oh, man. Wrong game, Gooch. The card, rather. So the Overflowing Gifts, very strong early game. They activate it and grants 14 health per second for 14 seconds. You do the math. But early on, 14 health a second, that's a substantial amount of health, and that can be the difference between giving up a kill and getting yourself a kill as well. Lane's taking shape. It looks like that Baylife are sticking to the tried and true death ball a little bit here inside of the jungle, while Warpath Gaming, they're being a little bit more of the lane style, putting themselves in lane. Sparrow over in the left. First Sparrow we've seen today. We saw her yesterday. So keep an eye on Cordy. Keep an eye for Baylife to try to punish the Sparrow, because you don't want to let a Sparrow just get free farm. And you want a really good strategy that a lot of teams do is focusing down a Sparrow and making sure you hinder her farm as much as possible.
Yeah, we do see them heading over to pick up this blue camp for... my colors are backwards. That's Warpath Gaming.
Correct.
They are picking up the blue camp right now. We do see, of course, Baylife is also at their red camp now. So we're going to see 2 minutes 30 seconds, guys, again, is when these camps spawn. They used to keep the spawn at a minute and 30, but that has been changed. So, I mean, potentially we can see a fight in the jungle, but from what we've seen, the teams are picking up their buffs and they're headed back out to their lanes.
Yeah.
Which I think is the best way, honestly.
Yeah.
You're getting 1,600. If you're at both, you get 1,600 card experience. If you're at one, that's 800 card experience. That's a lot of card experience at level one or level two. And then you're back into your lanes immediately, and you're soaking that lane experience. If you're able to last hit every minion, which you have to be really good, but if you're able to last hit every minion, that's another like 800 card experience just for the lane as well.
Yeah.
So we will start to see these teams get better at the last hitting. We will start to see people gain card points really, really quickly when they land all of those last hits. It's easier for some characters. For example, Iggy and Scorch, they throw their turrets down. They're able to get a lot more last hits rather quickly, so they can get their card levels up really, really fast.
Notch, I think your phone's going off.
No.
I could have heard it vibrate. I swore I heard it vibrate.
Oh,
that's
you
okay.
Did hear it vibrate.
See? I told you, man. I'm here for you. Check your messages, man. It might be from the POTUS.
It's
so.
Just the-
Is
He's
it the
out.
POTUS?
Obama out. He drops the mic, ladies.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Don't drop your phone, though.
No.
So, looking at the roles with Iggy and Scorch being on both sides of the field here, are we going to see stylistic differences? I think so. Already, we see Force, Boas, Force, whatever you want to call him, in the mid lane. We saw him yesterday, first appearance of him today. His strength is in his ability to clear waves and can be very disruptive in team fights. We actually saw kind of like some Iggy flanks, which were really, really interesting. Where he would actually come in with his ultimate, use his ultimate does a considerable amount of damage, use the knockback to throw enemies out of position into your backline, and it all comes down, I think, it's all about map awareness on Iggy's, knowing when you can push, knowing where you need to be, when you need to be there, knowing when to retreat, and more importantly, when it comes to team fighting, getting as much value out of that ultimate as you possibly can without putting yourself in an awkward position to get picked off. So keep an eye on these Iggy players. Those are the big ones you want to keep an eye out, guys, in these team fights. And for those of you who are aspiring Iggy players, always take those things into consideration. Mid lane is under siege here. Looks like that Baylife is just kind of doing a 1-3-1 in the mid lane here. It's under quite a bit of pressure. I feel like they could push this because actually a majority of Warpath Gaming are all the way back at their base. They all recalled here. So the response is there, but it's going to be a little bit late, and they might just give up this tower for free. I think they will, actually.
Yeah, I think they're going to take this tower. I do want to point out, though, you mentioned it. Wrath Z actually replaced his card. He now has a Mad Spore Sash.
So
both Rampage players are rocking the Mad Spore Sash, which is such a strong card.
Yeah, it's we talked about it earlier, guys. And obviously, Sevron can get it, and so can Rampage. It's actually one of the reasons why I think we've been seeing Rampage banned out a little more. Like, he's a strong hero, yes, but him with the Mad Spore, the Sash, is such an incredibly strong card. Immediately, Baylife, they got mid lane. They're happy with that. Now rotating over to the right lane. So definitely different stylistic differences from, I think, any other team we've seen today. Pushing down mid lane. I don't know if that was intentional or if it just kind of fell into their lap. I feel like it was the latter. They're just like, hey, we're going to push this lane. The lane's pushed out. We don't see anyone from Warpath Gaming on the field. Let's push this lane in. But I'm surprised they went to right lane. Now, this is what I was just about to say. Left lane is such an important lane when it comes to the Orb Prime, when it comes to those Reb camps. And I like that Rampage is going in here. Thorborn might be in a little bit of trouble. He's going to rocket dash away to safety. He'll be all right. And that is why Twin Blast is actually one of the better solo laners, because he can traverse this ravine right here, jump over it, and get himself to safety much better, much more safely than almost any other hero. If they don't have some sort of mechanism that can get themselves over that, then I think that more likely would have been the first blood right there. But thankfully, the push continues. Looks like a 3v3 over in the left lane. In the right lane, it's going to be Undead Pilot. I'm sorry, not Undead Pilot. Easy Peasy versus Iggy. And actually, they've been trading blows pretty hard here. Both of them are pretty low. And when you see a situation where it's a 1v1 lane and both of them are ranged and both of them harassing, which one has health potions? Undead Pilot does not have health potions. Kirby has mana potions, so they got to be... Or I'm sorry, Voas, rather. Had that on backgrounds. Does have health potions, while Easy Peasy does have a health potion as well. So neither of them can really bully each other out of the lane unless one of them makes a big misstep.
Take a look at Force's options here. Force's cards here. Force has a Lord's Ward, so he's going to be able to place two Shadow Wards. Then he also picked up a Lord's Key.
Yeah.
So he's playing. We've got health and mana, so I think we actually
He's level 5. He's under a lot of stress. They did get him in the containment field. He's going to have to pop his ultimate. They're stunning around Wrath Z. Now, Wrath Z is not level 5 Rampage, so I don't know if this is an engagement that Warpath wants to take, but actually Baylife might consider going in aggressive on this, but their Decker T-Cell is a little bit low on energy. I think if he had good energy, that's actually an engagement they more than likely would have want to take. They could have focused down Wrath Z, exploiting the fact that he's not level 5, but...
Easy Peasy is chasing down Force through the jungle here. Force is very low.
Ooh, Kirby's coming around with a flank as well. I think more than likely... Can Force get out of here? He might be able to. More than likely not. One more auto attack's going to do it. And there's your first blood. And that's going to be not only for your Murdoch. You can tell they're not picking up the card experience yet because he's wanting to wait for the rest of his team is there. That might have been a little bit too greedy of a play. It's going to put him in an awkward position for Warpath Gaming to rotate and take him out. And there's that ultimate I'm talking about. The damage, huge amounts of damage, just alone that Iggy and Scorch ultimate got Undead Pilot down to about 15% HP. They actually knocked him away, though, from the rest of his team. So he's going to get away, maybe try to re-engage here. He's not level 5, though. Rassi gets taken out despite the fact that he had an ultimate, didn't have enough energy, or just didn't have enough time to pop it. And all of a sudden, a 2-for-1 exchange going the way of Baylife right there.
Good stasis bomb from T-Cell, able to come in and actually got a stun and allow Easy Peasy to back off a little bit and then re-engage after he popped his health pot.
So with that first real big exchange, we're starting to see a little bit of a card experience here for Baylife. Nothing to be too concerned for you Warpath Gaming fans out there. That just was, to be honest, too greedy. You could tell that he wasn't picking up the card experience. He was waiting for the rest of his team to show up. And he basically literally overstayed his welcome, allowed time for Baylife to collapse. I'm getting the teams mixed up because the colors are throwing me off here.
But, okay.
but you guys basically, yeah, too greedy of a play. Just get the card and then get out of there. Maybe you could have gotten away. Maybe you could have lived. But it's going to be okay for Warpath. They're still in an okay position.
What is your time at?
I am at 19:20.
You're at 19 minutes?
I'm sorry, not 19. No, 9.
9:20.
9:20. No, I'm actually ahead of the future right now.
Let me know when you get to 9:30.
Now.
Thank you.
So the secondary, the second spawning of the red and blue camps has been on the field. Sometimes we see some calculated aggression, some timings around this second spawning of these, but simply not going to be the case. We see the blue orb putting on Kirby. Obviously, blue orb is very good on your energy-based heroes. The heroes who use their abilities to be impactful in fights, not necessarily your auto attack, that's what you reserve the red orb for. That's exactly where these guys are going. That's 800 card experience apiece on this camp, 1600 card experience at this stage of the game. That's about two-thirds of a card level individually, so that's why you see these teams always converge together to get as much, be as efficient as possible. And efficiency was a big part of the game, a big thing that... I think it was Kill on Sight. Yeah, Kill on Sight, who unfortunately were knocked out in the last semifinals, but Kill on Sight were so good at farming the map efficiently. We've seen Baylife kind of doing the exact same thing. It's all about that efficiency, easy peasy. There's no mid tower. We saw the mid tower go down. I guess you're not used to having your mid tower taken out. And easy peasy, if they get the stun, if Rassi gets the, or not Rassi, if Rassi wasn't there, rather, was not there, that more than likely would be easy peasy going down. But thankfully, his team collapsed. Gonna protect him, live another day. Right lane though, Force pushing in this lane hard. He's actually skipping the tower, and he's gonna be clearing, basically causing, he's a lane skipping, which is exactly what you wanna do here. The response is gonna be too late. More than likely, this right tower is gonna go down.
I would love to watch this.
Okay.
I'm stuck under the map. I have been for a few minutes here. There we go, we're back out. I found it. If we take a look at the harvesters, guys, it does look like the harvesters are in favor of Baylife right now. They do have the boss harvester, if I'm not mistaken. My colors are backwards.
You are correct.
But they do have the boss
diving harvester. Under a tower. Every time this happens, every time a team dives under the tower, doesn't really work out well. But they're focusing the tower, they're not focusing heroes, and that's exactly what you need to do. The tower's down, that means now you reinitiate. Isu's going in, he's gotta be careful because they're both really low. I'm pretty sure Rassi has his ult on. He's gonna have to pop it here soon. He's getting pretty low. He can't be too patient. He's gonna find himself in a bad position. He hops away, but he actually doesn't use his boost to get him out of there. The stun onto Kirby. Tier 2 towers there. Can they burst Kirby down by the time he gets underneath his tower? The answer is they're gonna sure as hell try here, not. They're going in there. Down he goes. Isu, he's trying to kill off the Iggy and the Scorch. Can they get him? They do. But at what cost? Undead Pilot throws down the devastating blast, and they're diving underneath his tower. Isu's very low. They need to turn and focus. Isu, his ultimate's going to be up. I feel like that they can take him down, get something out of this. Thurboard actually takes the tower damage. Isu chased so hard underneath the tower, he no longer is pulling the tower aggro. And all of a sudden, oh no, the tower diving. We've seen this so many times, Josh, where the team's tower dive, they get so greedy, and it almost never works out in their favor.
They got two kills out of it, but they did lose two in the process. This tower is stuck. Oh, we do see a rotation over from Easy Peasy.
Oh, now.
Undead Pilot is going to fall. Isu falls and Undead Pilot both go down. So, yes, the tower dive, man. It has been the death of so many players. We did have an ultimate from Rampage. Rampage ultimate went out. But like you said, he wanted the other Rampage so hard.
He did, man. So hard.
So hard.
So
and
hard.
It actually cost his team a couple of needless deaths there.
That was, I mean... The problem was Isu chased so hard he pulled the tower aggro off of himself onto his teammates, and that's when things went bad. I feel like they got themselves a kill early on underneath that tower dive, but you gotta know when to be like, okay, we got a kill under a tower, we probably should leave now. But unfortunately, the latter part of that strategy didn't play out like they were expecting. In fact, didn't play out at all. And they gave up three easy kills, and now looking at the numbers, we do see that there is a little, maybe about one card level here for Baylife, but they didn't get the tower. They gave up kills on very important targets, two very important people as well. To your, you don't want to be giving up that card experience to your Sparrows, your Murdochs, your Twin Blasts. It just gets their progression going just so much more exponentially faster. Speaking of which, keep an eye on the Sparrow. I told you I was going to keep an eye on him. She's actually out. Actually, Cordy is only at card level 15. You compare that to Baylife, I mean, they're at card level 21. Sparrow's pretty underfarmed right now, so that's something Warpath Gaming, they have to make sure they create space and make sure their Sparrow gets farm, or else come, or you know, they're going to start getting walked over here. Sparrow needs to get her farm, or she just simply isn't impactful in the later stages of the game.
So I want to ask you a question here. We just saw a tower dive. If you follow the forums, well, we might have an engagement, so I don't know if you can answer it. I'll give you just a second here. We do see some posturing around the boss. Of course, Purple Gummy Bear, about 14 minutes in the game. We like to see teams like love this buff. The OP Prime card, when you activate it, it's insane damage to towers, minions, and you also get a nice boost yourself. So we could see an engagement here. It does look
there
like
it is.
They are going to back off a little bit. Am I ahead of you again, or are we're okay?
My camera freaked out for a second. I lost control of it.
So this is my question. If you follow the forums at all, a lot of people are saying these towers are too weak. When we see a dive like that, yes, we lost some heroes, but do you think the towers could use a little bit more scaling? Do you think we could see them deal a little
bit
more
so.
Damage?
in that situation, we saw the tower dive was just, I mean, they got punished for it, but they were underneath that tower for the better part of like 10 to 15 seconds.
Right.
Maybe they could scale a little bit more. I feel like maybe what's something they should do is, and I think this actually already might be the case, I'm not entirely sure here, correct me if I'm wrong, is that the each tower, as you push into towers, needs to be substantially stronger than the other. The
right.
Tier 2 tower should have, like, double the HP and double the damage. All the meanwhile, though, we actually saw Baylife. What they were doing there, what are the strengths of Iggy? Iggy can actually solo the Prime Helix boss, as we just saw there, by himself. And all the mean, they utilized that strength of him and pretty much zoned out the entirety of Warpath Gaming in this area while we were talking about that. So, Baylife, great just playing into the strength of their draft, utilizing their Iggy appropriately, creating the space for him to get it. And now, all of a sudden, we see the first Prime Orb on Isu, and it's nigh impossible to stop a good Rampage from turning this in. So the call from Warpath, they need to figure this out. Are we going to just let them turn in the Orb Prime and they overextend and we pick them off? Or we'll see how this plays off. Right now, it looks like a standoff in the mid lane.
Yeah, we do see the standoff mid lane. Isu does have the Prime Orb. It's a Rampage, boys. He can roar and hop, leap, alt and halt, hop. This is going to be a tough one, dude. Are we going to see the split push? It does look like the Iggy and Scorch force is going to start clearing out his lane a little bit. I don't know if he's actually going to push, but he is going to clear out his lane a little bit, drop a couple turrets, and back off. But we may see a split push. What is
I think
force?
That's what we're going to see. Force right now, yeah, he is in that right lane. That is correct. The Tier 1 tower is already taken out here, so going to be putting pressure on a Tier 2 tower. What Warpath Gaming to do is recognize that the split push is there and be like, okay, well, then we can take a favorable engagement, right? But we just saw what happens when you tower dive, and they're just hanging out underneath this 3-1 tower in the mid lane. So they're pretty right now, they really, I don't know if they have any hopes of potentially turning this in, if they're just more using this as a distraction tactic to open up some space, and that seems to be the case right now. Force looks like he's backing off a little bit. He's pushed in that right lane. Left lane is pushed out as well, and now there's the rotation. I was just about to say, I expect to see that rotation from Baylife here to start rotating around to the left part of the map. They do have that Tier 1 tower down, so they have a much more open and free avenue to traverse across the terrain to get this turned in. And the right lane being pushed in by Force forces the hand of Warpath Gaming to dedicate their A-game Scorch to the right part of the map. The moment they see, I almost guarantee you, the moment they see Kirby on the minimap is going to be go time for Baylife.
Yeah, we did see Iggy Force was able to push all the way back to that Tier 2. He did back off. He's defending the Tier 1 tower. But, you know, he's allowing his minions to get on those towers and deal damage. So Warpath Gaming has to respond and send their Iggy and Scorch over to clear up that tower so they don't lose a Tier 2. I mean, Isu, he could roar and leap here. He still has probably only another minute with the buff stays on you for about 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So they may let it fall off.
Look at mid.
He could try and
mid's pushed out, right's pushed out. This is such an awkward position for Warpath Gaming. Their lanes are pushed in, but they got to defend over this. Here comes Isu. They're going in. This is the go time. He jumps over him. There's pops the ultimate. He's going to jump once again. More likely turn this in. So I'm with Warpath Gaming. I would initiate hard. Initiate right now. That's exactly what they're doing. Do it decisively. Rassi's going to jump out of the containment field. Undead Pilot is going to be the pilot. His plane's going to get knocked right out of the sky by Rampage. Boas, he's using his ultimate. Beast Wars got to be careful. Does a lot of damage. Respect the damage, or else you're going to burn, but they don't even care. Apparently, they're firefighters. They got their bunker gear on. They're going to take out the Iggy and Scorch. So two down right now for Baylife. They got the Orb Prime. This is exactly what you do. The moment they recognize the Rampage jumped over them, all of a sudden, the Baylife didn't have a front line. They capitalized on that opportunity, but now they overextended. They're diving underneath their tower, and we talked about it ad nauseum. Don't dive under the towers. Thankfully, they are retreating. They gave up the Orb Prime, but they got two kills for it. So Warpath Gaming definitely are going to be happy with that exchange right there, Josh.
Yeah, very favorable exchange for Warpath Gaming. We do have some strong characters. I mean, Thurborn on Twin Blast, he will benefit from this Orb Prime, but losing two players for the Orb Prime, so you have, you know, only one real damage dealer with it, it may have been a mistake. They're not going to lose any towers, I don't think.
They did get it, right?
They did, yes. They did cap it.
Yes, they did. Okay, just making sure.
Yeah, they did cap it. So what we will see here is we'll probably see these guys. They could take this tower if they decide to push. Undead Pilot is back up. He's coming back to defend. I think we'll just see them back off and play it safe here. But definitely favorable engagement for Warpath Gaming there. Good defense.
So they still find themselves at a considerable deficit. Looking at Cordy, Cordy's so under farm tier notch. Only level 9. Well, actually, isn't too bad. The level isn't bad, but only 21 card points right now. Card level 7 compared to the 10. They have 3 card level 10, so down 3 card levels on your Sparrow. That's the late game situation is, despite the fact that Warpath Gaming just had a favorable exchange, the card experience didn't get over to Sparrow. Sparrow just doesn't seem to be farming that much. I mean, she definitely has some space here. Delanes are pushed in, so she can definitely be picking up this farm. But I would expect this Sparrow to be at least card level, card level 6 or 7 at best. But she's nowhere near it. Or she is at card level 7. I'm sorry, card level 30 card points. Card level 10. There we go. Nailed it. Math is hard.
Got it, boys. She definitely has time to build back up here. She's not terribly far behind. I'd like to see her in lanes a little bit more right now. Defend her in a lane. Start getting some of that card experience from lanes. And of course, harvesters. Harvesters are so important. We talk about this. We see full harvesters. Peace Turtle is actually currently up here. He picked up some. He's gonna empty out this harvester. That is a lot of card experience for your entire team. It's not the person who picks it up. That card experience is shared with your entire team. Yeah. Utilizing these harvesters properly, they fill up after 5 minutes. You can get 300 to 400 card experience after
330 card experience is what they have in max. So that times the amount of harvesters you have with the card level being about 2,800 card experience. You guys do the math to understand how important harvesters are. Isu, is he gonna do it again? Isu. Take a chill pull, my man. Take a chill pull, my man. They're going under the tower. They need to focus down the tower. The prime cards have been deactivated. Isu's taking it up. He's going to get... They're trying to burst him down. They're trying to burst him down. They're not going to be able to do it. But they're at least going to make him run away. Oh, beautiful containment field. Isu has to pop his ult. He's going to get taken down. He must have to have it up. There it is. He isn't there, so this might be a potential turnaround. Cordy finally being a little bit of impactful in these team fights, but she's so under-farmed, she's not doing enough damage. Thankfully, their Twin Blast is kind of picking up the load right there. What a beautiful containment right field there, Josh. And now they're trying to turn around. Isu, his ultimate is going to be up. Isu needs to get out, or he's going to get turned on. He needs to get out, or he needs to get turned on. He's low. There's the ultimate from Boaz. It's going to knock away Rassi. We see Isu jumping away, but the push continues. They take out T-Cell. The Decker is down. 3 for no thus far. Warpath game, you're going to be having. Make it 4. Can they get the handful? Can they get all 5? Isu's running away with his tail tucked up between his legs. Second unfavorable exchange that Baylife has done. Maybe not under a tower, but still not in a favorable position. Warpath Gaming are going to be happy with that one. Pick up a tower. The Orb Prime boss is going to be up momentarily, but the main focus here should be regaining some of that map control, which they haven't had for the better part of about 10 minutes.
Right. Well, we just saw there, guys, Kirby was able to place his turrets down underneath the tower.
Yeah, Kirby was huge in that fight, man.
Yeah, Kirby was massive. So Kirby came up. He placed his turrets down underneath the tower. Those towers will take, or his turrets will take damage from the tower. He gave time for the minion wave to come in, so his heroes were safe. They pushed the tier 1, and they're now working on this tier 2 tower down in mid lane.
Tier 2 in the mid lane, man. We talk about how important this mid lane, I almost said mid lane harvester. That'd be interesting. Why don't they put a mid lane harvester in there? That would be awesome. They should totally do that. the mid lane tier 2 tower, because it opens up these two entrances to the jungle right here, guys. And all of a sudden, you can, when you want to, at will, invade, keep that lane pushed out. And it's also a little bit of a narrow fighting area. There's a lot of verticality to it. You see these ledges over here. It opens up a lot of interesting strategical fights. And more so, the main thing is it just opens up the opponent's jungle through several different avenues for you to go in there. And we already see the jungle actually isn't... There's only one ward for Warpath Gaming inside of Baylife's jungle right now. But still, they could... the red buff just spawned. The blue buff just spawned for Baylife. And this is definitely an opportunity if Warpath Gaming wants to show some aggression, they could. But I think with the way that they've been playing and the fact that they're just all recalled to the base, more than likely we'll see to take what we can get from that fight. It gave us that a big infusion of card experience that we needed. Specifically, Cordy, all of a sudden, up to 30 card points. That team fight's huge. She was at 21 just a couple minutes ago, Notch.
Yeah,
and
just
in that last team fight, she got 3 card points. And now she's tied with the Decker. She's tied with several team members of Baylife right now.
Yeah, a great team fight for them. Good engagement. With that engagement started under a tower. I don't know how many times we have to say it. You dive a tower, you get punished for it. We've seen it time and time again. And they got punished. They lost the tier 2 tower. They lost people. And like you said, Cordy is now almost even with card experience.
Yeah.
Her late game is she's not going to suffer so much. She's got that infusion of card experience. She's going to start building a lot more damage here. And she's going to be a real issue if they can defend her or keep her safe while she's backlining and just dealing out the damage.
So looking at her itemization thus far and her progression, that Blade of Agora, very, very important. After that, you see that crit item coming into play. That's exactly going to be the case. 32% crit chance. More than likely, her next item will be a spear, another Spear of the Rift Hunter, a little bit more crit to get her in that 40 to 60%. And two or three more card levels, and Sparrow is going to be that late game factor. That last team fight was, if if Sparrow wasn't there or that team fight didn't go the way it did, Cordy would be so far behind right now that there's a certain point where Sparrow just is no longer a factor. She's more of a ball and chain on your ankles if you have an underfarm Sparrow when you start getting into the 25-plus minute territory here. So that team fight was huge in so many different ways, but the biggest thing that they got out of that is that big infusion of card experience into the late-game carry now put them on even odds right here. And this is, I would actually say, at this stage of the game, Baylife has been ahead a majority of the match, but now they find themselves in a situation. They don't have a Sparrow. They have good late game, but we all know Sparrow is considered the best late game ranger in the game. If this game goes too long, they're going to find themselves getting just chunked away by the Jennifer Lawrence Cordy right here.
We do see a little positioning around the purple gummy bear box. Wrathzy was on Force. Force, of course, is going to back off, but it does look like Easy Peasy got picked out. And that was going to fall.
That containment fear from T-Cell actually avoided the rest of his team to pick him up. Now Pyrtle actually might have put himself in a bad position right here. He's just getting chunked away by Thirdborn. Devastating Blast right down the choke point. Into the fray we go once again. Henry V Shakespearean, ladies and gentlemen. Kirby, he's going to lay down the law. He's doing the big burn. Thirdborn, they got to kill him. They're just going to knock him back. It's actually knocking him back to safety. He does go down. This is not looking good for Warpath Gaming. A very hectic fight in the middle of this choke point. A very awkward fight. I feel like Warpath Gaming, they should have backed up. They lost one. Fall back. You cut your losses. But unfortunately, Baylife put themselves right back into this game.
They really did a great engagement. They were able to catch Easy Peasy out.
Where did Rassi go? He just juked him so hard. He's going to get away. That's Rampage, boys.
Yeah, he's out of there, boys.
You just straight Michael Jordan just dunked him right there, boys.
Now the issue is now is they Prime Orb. It's going to be uncontested.
Yeah, you're right.
You have people off the map. They can rotate down and try to defend this, but by the time they get here, it's going to be down. You look at that turret damage. He's got three turrets from Iggy and Scorch without just dealing damage, plus his oil slick. This thing's just melting, and yeah. It's a level two. Tried to steal it with the ultimate there. Unfortunately, just a little bit too late.
You are officially diamond there, Notch. Sorry about that. You'll see what I'm talking about in chat here in just a moment. So the Orb Prime, thank you. The Mirobot, that's such a cool thing. That's so really cool that the Mirobot has that little thing in chat right here. That's something we can have more full-time. Pretty interesting talking about. Anyways, I digress. Orb Prime's taken, and they're more than likely to use this again as just the card that forces the hand of Warpath Gaming and see what the play is. We see it time again. And left lane is just completely open right now. It is pushed out for Warpath Gaming, so they're going to have to push that lane out if they ever want a hope of going there, at least the normal means of activating that prime, that Orb Prime right here. Looking at the builds for Iggy's, let's talk about that and take a moment while we have a moment. It is a little bit of a tankiness. Force, aka Voas, is now building into a little tankiness now instead of doing it right away. Got that temper plate, has 1 3-point upgrade of greater guard, physical damage mitigation. Could go with more health, could go with damage mitigation, but nonetheless, it's still a build with emphasis. Initially, he went with that meltdown into Cass, and ever since then, he's been building a little bit more tankier, the Toon Barrier over here with the energy armor, so Force's Iggy, man. That seems to be coming the standard on these Iggy and Scorch. Just go maybe one damage item, put focus into utility, either or, and then just go tanky, 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 make you so hard to kill that I'm going to split push, and you can't punish me with my split push because you can't kill me.
Right. I do like the choice of for Force, the meltdown. Not only is he getting that energy damage, but he's also getting a little bit of energy pen. So he's ignoring some of the energy, the guard that Wrath-Z has built up, and some of the members of Warpath Gaming. So he's going to deal a little bit more damage on these guys while giving himself a nice damage boost with that card. I do like tanky Iggy and Scorch, though. Again, if he decides to split push, he's safe. He doesn't have to instantly worry about being picked off. His split push is so strong.
Look at the Mirobot. It's just my chat experience. Hashtag my chat experience.
They found it. It's been sitting there for a while, and I'm surprised they just now found it.
Isu, he's going to get the Orb Prime turned in. Much less of a contention than we saw before. They're going to try to punish him. It's hard to punish this Rampage with not only his Prime card activated, making him that much more tankier, but they might actually get collapsed on potentially. There's the first leap. Is he going to use his ultimate to leap away again? He might have to. They're chasing. I have a concern that they're going to get collapsed on here, though. It looks like that's not going to be the case because Baylife, look at your minimap, is already rotating down to that mid lane. So maybe Isu just, hey, chase me while the rest of my team pushes down your lanes. Nonetheless, Warpath Gaming has to make sure they don't chase too hard, as that's all of a problem that a lot of us have, is chasing a little bit too hard. And they're finally starting to realize that it was simply a distraction, and they're now rotating down to the mid lane, which is already under a lot of duress right now. If I can ever click on the person I'm going to click on. There you go. Kirby's there, thankfully. If you want one person defending against a push, it's your Iggy and Scorch. So thankfully, Kirby is there to defend against this pressure. And not sure what Baylife want to do here. We know what happens when they're underneath Tower's Notch. They have the Orb Prime, sure, but they have to be very careful about this situation. Warpath, they're starting to extend outside of their tower. They're not under the confines of the safety of their Tier 2 tower right now. And we know that Baylife loves initiating almost haphazardly sometimes. Devastating Blast, that actually was on Undead Pilot. He's pretty low. Is there any follow-up from that? I don't think there's going to be follow-up. Yes, it is. The Containment Field actually, oh no, puts Rath-Z. That was the Peace Turtles Containment Field. That's not what they wanted. It's going to put Isu in a bad situation. We know he has his ultimate, though. Thankfully, it wasn't forced out earlier. Don't forget, Baylife has their Prime Card activated right now, so this is not an advantageous team fight for Warpath to take. They really have to outplay Baylife if they want to have any hope of winning this team fight. Boaz, though, he's using that ultimate. Look at all the damage go down. Huge amounts of AoE damage. Puts him in the corner like Street Fighter. Up against the wall is what's going to happen, but it is a 2-for-2. And even exchange thus far. Isu, ultimate runs down, distracting Peace Turtle. Cordy's trying to do what he can, but attacking the Rampage is not what you want to do as a Sparrow. The Sparrow, you want to be over here. Take out the Iggy. Rassi is over a little bit overextending as well. He's trying to take away Iggy. Iggy's so tanky. I don't know if the damage is there. Iggy has just enough energy to use his speed boost. The right click from Cordy's not there. Boaz more than likely going to get away. No! The Rock Front there! The Rock Bottom, the People's Champion! Can he do it? Can he drop the Rock Bottom? He ends up does getting it. So a 3-for-2 exchange. Sparrow seems to be a little bit more impactful in these team fights now. And wow, that team fight could have gone anyone's way right there, Joshua.
Great escapes from Isu and my colors are backwards from Isu and T-Cell. But wow, I mean, what a team fight. It didn't happen under the tower. We saw a really good containment field come out of T-Cell. They were able to pick up a couple kills. Both teams got a couple kills, but that definitely in favor of Warpath Gaming because they took off the prime buff off multiple heroes there.
Yeah. Do you smell what the Rampage is cooking? I am using that catchphrase in the next team fight, guys. I'm so glad someone caught on to the fact that I was referencing WWE. Thank you so much to my fellow 80s and late 80s, early 90s millennials. You guys are the best, and we love you so very much. New other millennials are great, too, though. I think millennials were the best generation that this planet has ever seen. Anyways, I'm talking about like the whole socioeconomic standards that have been put upon us because the institution and all this stuff. Screw that noise. Let's talk about Paragon. Looking at the current state of the game, let's look at the numbers, my man. There's a slight lead, but I feel like it's negligible. Rassi is at 48. He's going to be super tanky. More importantly, Cordy has really made up that difference. He's still behind about 2 to 3 cards, but he was behind almost like, 4 card levels at one point. So they're putting themselves in a situation where their Sparrow is going to start doing so much damage that Baylife is actually wants to be maybe a little conservative and a little bit more calculated when it comes to just initiating on the Sparrow, because Sparrow will punish you. If you can burst her down, awesome. But if you just throw yourself at her, we've saw that before, actually, with the match between SG and Kill on Sight. They always were trying to deal with the Sparrow, but if you have to put so much into the Sparrow to take her out once she becomes a big threat, which in just maybe 1 or 2 more card items, I think Sparrow's going to be that threat that we know her for, then that's not a situation you want to be in. It means it opens up the rest of your backline just to get walked all over there. So Baylife, they have to be very careful as we're hitting that late game situation. The dynamic of the game changes. The mindset of these teams has to consequently change and adapt with it.
You know, if Baylife takes another fight like they just did there and Warpath Gaming isn't capitalized again, they will be behind in card play. And you will set up that spare to do a ton of damage. We do see an engagement here. Rath-Z is on force. Isu is just, I mean, he's just slapping away. We've got slap by the sentry here.
How can he
is
slap?
On Kirby dealing a little bit of damage. But Kirby is built with a lot of health.
Where's the rest
as well,
of his team?
So
where's the rest of his team?
They're rotating the team. In right now behind him.
There's the containment field. Peace Turtle's in a lot of trouble. Actually gets able to jump away using the boots to get himself out of there. Undead Pilot, he's pretty low, but the containment field completely blocking the ultimate from Twin Blast right there. Rassi is completely by himself. He's got to be careful. He's going to have to leap away, but the rest of his team's coming around the corner. Here comes Isu, right on time to get Cordy. That's what I'm talking about. You got to take down the Sparrow. That's exactly what you need with Sparrow down. This is the go time for Baylife. Everyone on the side of Warpath Gaming is still very low, including the Rampage. Get down the Rampage and take the game, potentially. They do take him down. A 2-for-0 exchange. Baylife, this is what they're looking for. Everyone's so low. Warpath, you gotta get out. The path to victory is not in the war right now. It's in means of egress. Get yourself away to safety. The white flag is being shown right now from Warpath Gaming. They're gonna get picked apart. A 3 for Neil Exchange with the Orb Prime boss being up right now. So many ways that Baylife can potentially do this. Go down mid lane, get an inhibitor, fall back at the Orb Prime. They are now in a very substantial lead in almost every metric imaginable.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you saw that. Thurborn escaped with 23 health his Twin Blast. that is insane escape right there. That Wrath-Z kill came out perfectly. These guys are going to push down this inhibitor mid. Aisu is very, very low. He needs to be careful here. I think he popped his ult in the jungle, but they will get an inhibitor in mid, which is a favorable exchange for these guys. Amazing encounter, and they are now capitalizing off of those kills. They're going to get this tier 2 tower rotating to left lane to get this tier 2 tower down, and possibly, yeah, they'll just get the tier 2, and I think we're going to see them back off and play it a little bit safe.
Mid inhibitor, man. I mean, any inhibitor. Doesn't matter. Just any inhibitor.
Doesn't matter. They just got the mid inhibitor. That was the biggest benefit out of those guys right there. They've got that inhibitor. Now Warpath Gaming has to put somebody in that mid lane, make sure those super minions, super creep, what were we calling it earlier?
I call them mega creeps.
Mega creep? Mega creep.
I call them mega creeps. I played the original Dota way back in the day, hashtag hipster. So I have always known them as mega creeps, but we'll have to get to Paragon about what the specific vernacular it is when it comes to the creeps who are stronger than they were before. Well, yes. Maybe you want to call them that? Is that a little too verbose? And the creeps who were stronger than they were before, pushing down mid lane.
But Warpath Gaming is now going to have to put somebody in this lane to deal with the creeps that were stronger than before.
There we go.
I
love it.
It's going to be a pain in the butt for these guys.
we'll go with mega creeps.
Okay, mega creeps today. You sure? I really like the creeps that were stronger than before.
I mean, it's clear cut. It paints the picture for those of you new to MOBAs. It's like, oh, the creeps are stronger than they were before. That makes a lot of sense. A lot of posturing around the Orb Prime right now. Isu is. Are they going to do that again where they allow their Iggy to solo the Orb Prime, the Gummy Bear, as some might know it? We're going to continue to call it that until eventually it is going to have actual artwork implemented. The placeholder artwork is known as the Gummy Bear for those of you who are wondering. But they're kind of just zoning them out. The rest of Baylife isn't really showing up right now. Voas, aka Force, instead electing to push down this right lane. The last outer tier 2 tower. This is the last bastion of hope really available for Warpath Gaming before all of their inhibitors are potentially can be siegeable here. So they really have to make sure they protect the map which what little map that they have available to protect. Or we've seen teams lose just simply off of attrition right now. And the posturing around the Orb Prime continues. One team is trying to wait for another one to try to make a positional mistake or an overextension, spread themselves out too thin. And with this current status quo, Baylife is going to be perfectly content with it. You guys can sit back. We're going to sit here. We know we have the advantage in card experience. We want the team fight to be on our terms. And yeah, this is what we saw last time. Isu is going to zone out for the rest of the team, going to pick up the Orb Prime. What Warpath Gaming, they need to decisively engage right here. If they don't, they might just give up the Orb Prime and not get much out of it.
Rusty jumping in. He tried to get that last and he missed it. Undead Pilot does have the Orb Prime. We will see that team fight though in mid lane. Rusty is overextended by quite a bit.
Yep, but Isu's in a little bit of trouble. He's popped his ultimate. His secondary leap is on cooldown right now, but he's so tanky, he can sit here and just tank this damage while they're pretty much holding off the rest of the team. There's the counter initiation right there from Rusty. These guys don't want to engage on each other. Don't forget that the Orb Prime, I believe, is in the hands of Easy Peasy right now. Correct me if I'm wrong. No, it's not. Who has it? Undead Pilot. I'm sorry. Undead Pilot has it. There he goes. Now he's giving it to Isu. That's the target you want to see on right there. So, Warpath, they have to defend mid lane. They can't let the Orb Prime be turned in. Their tier 2 is going to be getting pushed in here momentarily with Iggy and Scorch being over there.
I would have liked to see them just give that Orb Prime buff up, the boss fight up, and just push lanes up.
Yeah.
There was too much posturing around that. They waited too long. Now, you know, instead of getting lanes pushed out and feeling a little bit more comfortable to come and defend, we do see the creeps that were stronger than before already at the inhibitor, and they're working their way up to the core. I'm not going to be able to stop calling them that, by the way.
Isu is going to get this. I actually don't know if he has his ultimate up. I don't think he does, actually. Isu? Hello? Team?
He was not.
He's going to get body blocked. Can they body block him? I think
he turned it in.
He did get the turn in, but he gave his life up for it. Not necessarily. I mean, that might be worth it because he's going to be back up in 50 seconds. He's not going to have it. But the people you want to have that prime card activation at this stage of the game, now that we're in the late game officially, is your Rangers, your Murdochs, your Twin Blasts. They both have it. Rampage is going to be back up. Even without the prime card, Rampage still is going to do what he needs to do in team fights: be disruptive, stun people at key moments, and initiate at key moments as well. So I actually don't mind that. I think Isu going down there, it's going to be a little bit of a delay. But ultimately, once he gets back up, if Baylife plays this appropriately, there's many different things that they can use this and just continue to get themselves closer and closer to a win condition.
Yeah, I see. You know, we do have Kirby. He's dedicated to this mid lane, or he was dedicated to this mid lane. He got it pushed out. We're going to see Force, Undead Pilot, and I think T-Cell head over to the right lane, and they're going to try and get this tier 2 tower down. They can see on the map where everybody's at. It is kind of a dangerous situation for them to jump in and do it. But I am curious to what the next play is here. They're down a tank. Yep. Well, their tank, Isu's up, but, I mean, he's would you engage at Warpath Gaming? Would you try and get an engage right now that they don't have Isu up, or he's not near this team yet?
I would, but don't forget, there's the prime card. You look at the itemization right now, you see that both Murdoch and Twin Blast are fully maxed out card, 60 card points right here. So that's a very, very dangerous position to be in, going into a fully, they've hit their peak, and with the prime orb on them as well, even engaging for 5v4, I'd be very hesitant to do so, unless it's on your terms, underneath the tower, underneath an inhibitor, something like that. Because the Twin Blast and the Murdoch are going to be so much damage. They're going to be, it doesn't matter if you're a Rampage, it doesn't matter who you are. You can be a Iggy that's built around being tanky. You're just going to take so much damage, you get blown apart, blown into pieces. Containment field, onto Isu. We've seen this before. They're going underneath the tower, but Isu, now he's going to get himself away. Retreat, they force the containment field, knowing that that ultimate's not on cooldown. I actually think it wouldn't be terrible for them to dive the tower. Isu, he's going to use the devastating blast on him. Actually, no, that was to clear the wave. I like that. They cleared out the wave. Now Baylife, we've seen it before, man. Can they dive a tower and do it calculated, or easy peasy's taking damage? This might be the go time for Isu because he's at very, very low, but he's getting snared up, actually. And this continues to be just a big stalemate, big standoff right here. Devastating Blast, traded for Devastating Blast. Easy Peasy's so wounded, he's going to have to go away and get himself healed up because he's so low. And when they recognize that Murdoch is back, I think they're giving up this tower. I like this call. Give up the tier 2 tower, heal up your Murdoch, defend the inhibitor more importantly. And speaking of which, mid inhibitor's back up. So Warpath Gaming, they still find themselves in this match.
Yeah, I mean, they delayed long enough. Cordy was sitting in mid lane, farming up some card experience. He was able to protect, or as soon as that inhibitor came up, he rotated over. But now they have to defend this inhibitor.
It's going to be hard.
There is a full creep wave here. They still have the prime buff for just
a minute.
It's going
to be hard. They're going to get it.
I think they're going to dive this, and Easy Peasy takes third ward down, but that inhibitor just...
Oh, no, Cordy. Inside of his own containment field. That's not what you want. Voess forces the early ult. The containment field on a Voess. Once again, that cooldown reduction is so important. Voess is so tanky, though. Look at this. It doesn't matter if you're a Sparrow or not. Look, it's so hard for them to kill this Iggy. Voess more than likely is going to be going down here, but they got the inhibitor.
Five people to kill this guy.
Look at that, man. Iggy and Scorch apparently are just like Rampage right there. But left lane is pushing in. That inhibitor is going to be under siege here. Mid lane is going to be pushing in. Two were taken down by Baylife, but again, man, giving up two for a inhibitor is almost all situations is worth it when you also have all of your inhibitors alive.
Yeah, I do want to point out one of the cards that Force is using. Drink the Spirits. It gives him health and mana, but
I'm all about that life.
A unique passive on unit kill or assist, heal for 5% of
which one is that?
Killed unit's health.
Oh, here it is.
Over 10 seconds. It's on Force. Amazing card to pick.
Interesting.
Up. So he's regenning health. He's tanky as can be. He's got quite a bit of health on him. What is his health at? Let's see. Well, as soon as he comes back to life, I'll tell you what his health is.
But his health currently is zero.
It is currently zero because it took five players from Warpath Gaming to kill him.
So, we might hit that stage where both teams max out. We're not too far off of it, as you do see Cordy. I mean, only three more card levels for the Sparrow and Decker of Warpath Gaming, and all of a sudden it's just going to be almost full 60 card points across the board. And if Warpath Gaming can just keep that right inhibitor lane from getting pushed too far in, and still at the same time keep a little bit of a presence on the map, they actually will find themselves in a situation where, up until this point, the lead that Baylife has had, if you're just joining us now, you would say, oh, there's right inhibitor down. Bayleaf has been ahead, but judging by the card experience does not tell the story of how Bayleaf has been dictating the terms of this game the entire time. It's actually somewhat even because of the fact that when you hit this late-game situation, it all comes down to execution and consistency. In the late game, if you're not consistent, you will get punished. You're eventually going to make that mistake if the other team is more consistent than you, and you'll lose the match. Bayleaf, they've been inconsistent in this match, though, Notch, and that's what I'm fearing. I feel like Warpath Gaming still has an avenue to take this game number one.
They really do. We've seen, like you said, inconsistencies. Warpath or Bayleaf is.
Did I say Bayleaf? I said Bayleaf.
You said Bayleaf.
I've been watching too much food Twitch. The food channel on Twitch, man.
Bayleaf has made some engagements, and they've lost major fights. So they have to play a little bit safe. They are taking down this purple gummy bear right now. They do have. Are we going to see rotation from Warpath Gaming, or are they just going to let it go? They are starting to show up. We may see them try to take a last hit. This purple gummy bear is at level 3. Is it level 3 or level 4? It's at level 4. So it has a lot more health. It does deal a little bit more damage. But Aisu's just going to zone them out. And it does look like Bayleaf will take this, no problem.
Actually, force out the ultimate from Sparrow right there on a core to Aisu. That's got to be careful, though, man. They're starting to chunk away at him. You can use the ultimate, the containment field as well. Just a little bit of a little annoyance, more of a curve than it is a containment field. The chase continues, though. Rassi, they know that Isu's ultimate on cooldown. They actually might be able to punish it. Not going to be able to. It looks like Thurborn is the one carrying the Orb Prime, but you better believe they're going to want to give that to Rampage. There it is. Michael Jordan has the ball. He's going to have to carry it across half court. He's going to have to dribble. He's going to have to juke. He's going to have to jive. But more than likely, as long as Bayleaf plays this correctly, they should be able to get turning that Orb Prime. And with so much damage with that Orb Prime and with their carries being maxed out, they should be, as long as they play this appropriately, they should at least get a single inhibitor off of this.
Maybe issue right now is Warpath Gaming has their creeps taking that damage. Were stronger than before on their core. They've got two waves of creeps that were stronger than before on their core right now, so they have to send Cordy back to defend, and it's taking a lot of damage. It's down to 50%.
Yeah, wow.
They've got minions. Cordy's going to show up, but I don't know if he's going to be able to defend it in time.
Like, I feel like when your core's at 50%, that just opens up just backdoor the core. Like, you can just go in and rush it down when it's that low, especially if they manage to get this Orb Prime turned in. You can tell Aisu.
Aisu takes the Orb Prime, or he gets lining up the shot. Orb Prime and the black buff,
they're
and he can just backdoor the core.
Yeah. This is a very, very awkward situation for Warpath Gaming right now because they let their core get down to 50%. I think we're going to see some desperation tactics coming out of them. As they are going in here, third one's actually in a little bit of an awkward trouble. That containment field, holy cow. Containment fence, containment wall, make America great again. His third one is going to get knocked back away. He actually is going to live right there. There's another containment wall onto third one. Good lord, we're going to go up and down over there.
Holy cow. Ladies and gentlemen.
And they do take out third one. So all of a sudden, two on the side of Bayleaf are dead here. This is not what that was looking for.
Look at Aisu. Aisu says, nay. He's got the Prime Orb. Oh. He's got an ultimate. He's going to try and backdoor this. It's
he can probably 50%. Get it. He can probably get this.
Yeah. And
oh,
still,
they catch him, though. This is what they need to do.
On top of it. This is going to be GG.
More than likely. I don't think they have the damage to burst him down here. He pops the ultimate. The core is going to, I don't know. This may be close here, man. They're knock him away. They need to knock him away. They need to keep him away. They need a containment field. They need something to keep him off the score. He's at half HP. He's at third HP. Can they keep the score alive? This may be the throw. This may be a 3-2-2. I think he's going to go down. He's not going to get the score. Holy cow. What a defense from Warpath Gaming. Wow. They still have the life. The right inhibitor is going to be responding momentarily, but the core still is under siege. It's down to about 15% HP. Look at Bayleaf. They know that they're in. Look at Undead Pilot. They're trying to sneak their way in there. They want to get in there. They do get the right inhibitor as well. So even though the game is still going, it still is a slow exsanguination. Death by hypovolemia is what's going to be happening for Warpath Gaming, man. With a core that low, all they have to do one more time, just get the black buff, as you mentioned, on Rampage, throw Rampage in there. That's more than likely how this game is going to end. I don't see a path to victory for Warpath Gaming right now. Pun intended.
I mean, you've got mid inhibitors down. This is the second time it's dropped. It's down for 8 full minutes.
Yeah.
We've got 5 minutes on the core on the left side of the map. Yes, the right inhibitor, right inhibitor has respawned. But, I mean, all this takes is black buff from anybody on the enemy on Bayleaf. So Bayleaf, we just saw, I believe it was Undead Pilot, he picked up the black buff, or did they give it to Aisu? Let's take a look here. Looks like Aisu has it. Undead Pilot does pick it up, and they're going to try and backdoor here, guys. The map awareness I don't think was there for Warpath Gaming, and they just let that core take way too much damage. So we are going to see these teams posture back up. As you can see, coming down mid lane here, we do have Cordy. We've got Peace Turtle and Easy Peasy. They're going to try and make some sort of counter push. Wrath-Z is trying to push down. Wrath-Z is trying to push down a tier 2 tower. He unfortunately does not have any minions with him, so he's not going to be able to do that. We are going to see a small team engagement here in middle. Aisu was caught out. Easy Peasy Peace Turtle even put some damage into him. He did pop his ultimate, but we've got a full backdoor. We've got Undead Pilot and Force walking up to the core here, and they are going to take that down.
There's no way they can stop this. There it is. Just two shots.
Two shots, and that's GG, ladies and gentlemen.
So, game number one, Warpath Gaming, you got to give it to them, Josh. They fought their heart out right there. They went to the very bitter end to keep themselves in game number one. Baylife, man, early on, they kind of had some questionable team fights underneath the tower, but didn't really matter. Game number two, I said Baylife 2-0, but Warpath Gaming, if they can play maybe a little bit stronger in the early parts of the game, and more importantly, I just felt like Sparrow's Farm was a big hindrance that game for Warpath Gaming.
Yeah, I mean, it's Sparrow's Farm, a little bit of lack of map awareness, letting those super minions come in, two waves of super minions come in and push your core down to below 50%. It was a huge mistake on their part. Hopefully we can see them come back in and adjust. We've seen Warpath play some really good games. Let's see if they can come back in and fix the mistakes they made this game. I do know that the second game bans are also Muriel and Steel. These guys are ready to just jump in.
Oh, we were
and
pretty
play
far
again.
Behind, weren't we? Yeah.
We were a little bit behind, yeah. These guys
Let's
are ready to jump
cut
in
cut it
and
to
play
a very
again.
Small break.
Yep.
Like just a minute or two, guys. We'll get into game number two. You said Muriel and Steel?
Muriel and Steel are bans for game number two.
Game number two. We already have the bans. Don't go anywhere. Coming up in just a couple minutes.